Hello, welcome. My name is Augustine Emeka Ekene. Today, I'm going to be making a presentation on the topic Deep Learning as a Tool to Predict Flow Pattern. Introduction. The term flow pattern refers to the spatial distribution of the phase which occur during gas-liquid two-phase flow in pipes. When gases and liquid flow simultaneously in a pipe, the two phases can distribute themselves in a variety of flow patterns or configurations. The flow configuration differ from each other in interface distribution, resulting in different flow patterns. So whenever there is a combination of gas and liquid flow inside a pipe, we can see things like bubbly flow. This is bubbly flow. This is a combination of gas and liquid. We can see wavy flow, we can see plug, we can see slug, we can see stratified or annular. So this is what we call flow patterns. It can be this or this. The essence of this our project is to be able to classify every flow into either bubbly, wavy, annular or stratified, given the superficial velocity of the gas or the liquid phase. So that's what we are trying to do. Now going forward with this introduction, determination of flow pattern is a fundamental problem in two-phase flow analysis. Indeed, the design variables, namely phase velocity, pressure drop, liquid holdup, heat and mass transfer coefficients, resident time distribution, and rate of chemical reaction calculations, all depend on flow pattern, and that is what we are going to be able to classify this flow pattern in order for us to make all these calculations, because all these calculations are dependent on the flow pattern. Now these are the various flow patterns that we have in horizontal pipe. So the essence of this project is to be able to, given a superficial velocity of gas and liquid with and pipe diameter, we should be able to say that this very flow should be a bubbly flow or wavy flow, so that we can use the model for bubbly or wavy to do the calculation for the parameters that we earlier listed, like phase velocity, pressure drop, and the rest of them.
The determination of flow pattern is a fundamental problem in gas liquid two-phase flow, because with the knowledge of the flow pattern, we can easily determine the phase velocity, the liquid holdup, the heat and mass transfer coefficients, as well as the pressure drop needed for our design.
Now, statement of the problem. Artificial neural networks have been used to identify and predict flow patterns. Because of the increase in computing power, researchers have developed deep learning techniques which are of great significance in process design, as the determination of flow pattern is needed for pressure drop and other calculations in process design. In many of these calculations, algorithms based on deep learning have surpassed the previous state-of-the-art performance. This research will explore the use of valuable tool of deep learning to solve the problem of flow pattern classification in horizontal pipes to a greater efficiency. Objective and or aim of the study. Number one, to identify and predict flow patterns in horizontal pipes. Two, to assess the impact of architectural parameters to flow pattern prediction efficiency. Significance of study or justification. Why are we doing this? This research will add to literature on the use of valuable tool of deep learning to solve the problem of flow pattern classification in horizontal pipes to a greater efficiency. The research will help to give a broader idea in the application of deep learning to other areas of chemical engineering. Literature review. There are works that have already been done on this, but they have their limitations, like the work of Binet in 1980 on flow pattern transition for gas liquid flow in horizontal and inclined pipes. They had the result that there is actually a proof that this method can be used to classify for horizontal pipe using the theory they postulated. But they had the limitation that the theory fails to predict the stratified smooth to stratified wavy transition for inclined plane. This is significant only for downward flow.
So when you look at the limitation from the last work that was done in 2007, you see that it was said that if there is this exhaustive study of the parameters, that better predictions can be obtained. And that is what I'm doing in this, that is what is done in this research work. We are trying to do exhaustive study of the parameters for the architecture so that we can get better predictions.
Now, materials and methods. What are the materials and methods used in this very research? In this research, feed-forward normal network known as multilayer perceptron is used. The first step in using the multilayer perceptron is determining an appropriate architecture. This means that we must determine the number of hidden units, the number of hidden layers, the type of activation function, as well as the number of inputs and output variables. The second step involves determining a training algorithm to estimate the weights and biases of MLP, which is multilayer perceptron. This involves iteratively solving an optimization problem to estimate the network's weights and biases so that the network output is as close to the desired output as possible. Now, what are the applications? Now, what's the essence of all this flow pattern determination and studying to do the right prediction in order to do calculations? This is actually because we can use this flow pattern in many industrial applications, like in pneumatic conveying system, in cyclone separators, in air pumps, in geyser pumps, in fuel injectors, in water jet machining, and in slurry type of transport pipeline. Now, what results are we expecting in this research? In this approach, a multilayer perceptron is trained on a set of randomly selected samples. Approximately 60% of the entire data set was used for training. Approximately 20% was used for testing. The next table we are going to see, table 2, shows the chosen multilayer perceptron architecture and parameters used in the experiment. Other design considerations are the choice of ReLU as the nonlinear activation function, the E1 and E2 regularization penalties to avoid overfitting, the number of epochs and end folds, the number of cross-validation folds. Expected result. What is the essence of this research? What are we supposed to see? What are we supposed to learn? We are supposed to, like in the objective, learn how to classify the flow patterns into the annular, wavy, or the rest of them. But now, to classify, we need specific architectural parameters. So that is the essence of this study, to find out these architectural parameters in order to do this classification. So by the end of this result, we are going to be seeing a table like this showing us the various parameters and their values. So the various values and their parameters, that is what we are supposed to do. This is similar from literature, what results from this similar research gave. So in our own, we are going to be finding the best number of inputs, the best number of hidden layers, the best number of hidden or layer topology, the best activation function, the best number of outputs in order to make better prediction. Conclusion. This paper is supposed to propose 6 types of flow pattern and a corresponding architecture to precisely predict flow pattern. First, it is shown that the network can learn surprisingly well as using a chosen architecture and parameter allow the achievement of high classification accuracy. Second, it is shown that the network can classify the different flow patterns with high efficiency. And finally, high precision predicting different combination of classes was achieved or is going to be achieved from this research. Now, these are the literature books that we are referenced, the journals that we are referenced for this work. Thank you for listening.
Hello, welcome. This is Austin from tclassify.com. Today I'm going to be working on deep learning technique used in classifying flow patterns. That's what I'm going to be looking at today. Deep learning technique used in classifying flow patterns. So the project is actually deep learning as a tool to predict flow patterns in two-phase flow. So we're going to be looking at using CoolLab to solve this problem using TensorFlow and using Keras and other machine learning algorithms. So The term flow pattern is actually the spatial distribution of the phases which occur during gas liquid flow in pipes. Now, we are going to be able to classify flows into things like wavy flow, stratified flow, and the rest. So we're going to be using a deep learning technique, and I'm actually using Colab. Colab is an app in Google Drive that you can use to write machine learning or deep learning algorithms. So this is my Colab that I just opened that I'm going to be using for this. The name of this is PRGMan. I'll drop a link in the description part to my GitHub where you can see the full code. So first of all, what I did was to import all the necessary make the necessary imports for this. I imported TensorFlow as TF, NumPy as MP, Pandas as PD, Seaborn as SNS, Matplotlib as PLT. So after making the imports, I now have to bring in my data. So this is the data I'm using. This data, I actually prepared this data by myself. The features which are going to be used for these predictions are the superficial velocity for gas, the gas superficial velocity, and the liquid superficial velocity. So that is are their values. I actually got these values from the Docker graph. I looked at the graph, and from the graph I was able to put this data together. Now these are the flow patterns that we are classifying to. So considering the superficial velocity, gas, and liquid, we can classify a flow to be stratified, wave, annular flow, slug flow, bubble flow, or dispersed. So that is what we are looking at. So getting back to my Colab, I now have to import this data that I have shown. This is my very data. I'm going to import it to Colab so that we can start the training and testing and every other thing. So, and that is what this code is for. From Google Colab import file, this is how you import files in Google Colab. So you click here and choose the file. The name of the file is my data. So I'm able to import this file. Then when I do import IO and DF, it falls to PD read CSV. This is how you use Pandas to read out CSV files, because I actually saved this my file. This is my Excel file. Immediately after working on it, I hit on the save as, then save as workbook. Then I came to this save type and I picked CSV. That is how you save to CSV. So this is CSV cover delimited. That's how I save this as CSV file. So I'm going to go to here and import it. So that's the code for importing it. Then here I'm able to read it into my Pandas data frame, and that is why you can see it like this. You can see that this is the same data that you're seeing in Excel. Now it's now in my Colab. This superficial velocity, gas, and that of liquid, and flow pattern classifications into various this thing. So after importing it and displaying the data frame, I'm able to use Seaborn to make a plot by using this code. This is the code. First of all, I was able to classify my flow patterns to read my data. I know that out of the 120 data that I have, 20 of them are stratified, 20 are bubble, 20 are wave, slug, annular, and dispersed. I did this in order to know that I'm not doing the wrong I'm not picking out the wrong data points. Then here I'm able to plot this data into graphs. Then using this other code, I'm able to split the data into training sets and testing sets. So I'm using 2% for test and the rest of the 80% for training. So this is where I did that. Then now I built the model. So using dense model for the first input layer, because I'm having only two inputs, superficial velocity gas and superficial velocity liquid. Then using ReLU as my activation function, this is the first layer. Then the second layer and the third layer, I used activation function as tan H for the both of them. Then my final layer, I use activation function softmax. I use softmax because if you want to classify something that is not one or two, you use softmax because it reads probability from 0 to 1. So you can actually read out what I want. Had it been in just two classes, I'm going to use sigmoid function. So I'm using softmax for search. Then I'm using Adam as my optimizer and categorical cross entropy as my entropy or loss function. Then my metrics, the metrics I'm calculating is accuracy. So I'm able to put out this this summary, which can also be put in graphical form. This summary, this is the code I use in putting it, model.summary. Then to put it in this form, I use this code to put it in this form, to plot it in PNG format. Then also use this as well to do the dot, model to dot, and plot it out. Then I use model.fit x-trend y-trend epochs 100 in order for me to train my model. So after training my model, I'm able to do the predictions. So using this, I'm able to use argmax in order to start predicting. Then I'm able to feed in these arrays for my testing. Then after that, I can now calculate my accuracy from the predicted value using this code and put this together. So from that, I can now make a sample prediction of this point 400 and 0.1 and all these points. So after making this sample prediction with this code, in order to predict whether it's stratified wave, annular slug, bubble, or dispersed, I'm able to get these various predictions. So this is actually part of my thesis. This is my first run of training using different method, not actually utilizing TensorFlow in details. So I'm using this as experimental to start up my thesis. In subsequent one, I'm going to use TensorFlow in details in order to make better prediction. Please, the code to this, I will link this code to my GitHub repository so that you can always go there and get this code. This is an example of using application of machine learning and deep learning in chemical engineering. Please, if you like this video, hit the subscribe button. If you have any questions and concerns, drop them in the comment section of this. Thank you. God bless you. Hello, welcome. This is Augustine Emeka from tclassified.com. Today, I'm going to be looking at the concept of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is one of the major aspects in computing that has been gaining much news, and people have been learning so much about it. So today we're going to be looking at it in details. Please, if you like this channel, for you to get more information on artificial intelligence, on how to go about coding it, hit the subscribe button. So we're going to be starting immediately. Now, what is artificial intelligence? Artificial intelligence is an area of computer science that emphasizes the creation of intelligent machines that work and react like humans. So basically, what you learn in artificial intelligence is how to make machines to behave like human beings. Some of the activities computers with artificial intelligence are designed for include speech recognition, learning, planning, problem solving. So when you say that a machine can do artificial intelligence, that means that that machine can actually learn. If you bring a picture of a goat, the machine should be able to tell you that this is a goat. Just like human being can look at a goat and say this is a goat, look at a monkey, a human being is able to classify different animals into monkeys and goats. The same way, a machine should be able to do that. Once a machine can do that, then you can say that that machine is artificially intelligent. It can also do speech recognition. It can recognize, just like a human being, when I hear the voice of my father, I can differentiate it from that of my mother. A machine can be able to do that. Learning, a machine can learn and be able to classify, just like I said before, goes from sheep. Machine can also plan and do other problem solving. So once a machine can do all this, you can say that that machine has the AI ability, has the ability of artificial intelligence. Now, in the field of artificial intelligence, you normally hear about AI, you hear about machine learning, deep learning. These words, sometimes they are interchangeably used. So how do you know how to classify them? Now, anything about machine learning and deep learning, they are all classified under artificial intelligence. It depends on the approach. So artificial intelligence is when you mimic the intelligence of human being for machine. Whereas machine learning is a technique by which a computer can learn from data without using a complex set of different rules, that is, without being explicitly programmed. This approach is mainly based on training a model from data sets. So when you train a model, or when you train a machine, when you continue supplying the machine the pictures of a goat and that of a cat, and you continue telling the machine that this is always a cat, this is always a goat, the machine will have the knowledge to be able to classify on its own. So machine actually learns from data. That's what we call machine learning. Now, deep learning is a technique to perform machine learning inspired by our brains.
our network of neurons. So whenever you're talking about deep learning, it's also a method of teaching machine something, but this time around you're modeling the algorithm based on the brain of a human being. So you can see that both machine learning and deep learning are approaches to solving problems of AI. They are approaches to making machine to be intelligent. So you can either use machine learning, in which way you're doing explicit algorithm that enables machine to learn from data, or you do deep learning when you are modeling your algorithm according to the neurons of the head of human beings. Now let's look at machine learning, then afterwards we look at deep learning. What is machine learning? Machine learning is an application of artificial intelligence that provides systems the ability to automatically learn and improve from experience without being explicitly programmed. Machine learning focuses on the development of computer programs that can access data and use it to learn for themselves. So in machine learning, actually what the computer does is to pick data. You keep feeding information or pictures of car, truck, bicycle and everything. The computer all of a sudden starts recognizing that whenever I see something like this is a car. Whenever I see something like that, this is a truck. Whenever I see something like this is a bicycle. So whenever it now sees a single picture of a car, it can be able to categorize and tell you that this is 95% of a car, and therefore it is a car. So that's actually what machine learning does. To learn from data, you must have supplied plenty pictures of cars and other things so that the machine will not be able to classify and tell you that this is this. That is what machine learning is. Now, machine learning problems could be of various types. It could be a problem of classification. You want the machine to be able to, anytime you receives email, to be able to tell you that this email is spam or this one is original email. That is classification. You're classifying because you are telling it that anytime it sees such thing in a email, that email is a spam, just like you have in your mail, Gmail or Yahoo. So that is a classification problem. You're classifying between two things, spam or not spam. Regression is when you're telling the machine to learn from features or from other characteristics to be able to predict what will be a value, a discrete value. That's what we call regression. Like you want to predict the price of stock from the what is happening in the stock market. That is regression. Clustering is when you also classify, but this time around you don't know where to classify into. Like you don't know whether you're classifying this mail into spam or not spam. You just say whenever you receive mail, just classify based on what you see. So you cluster simply means classifying without knowing beforehand the various classes or labels. Now the various machine learning problems can be put into graph. Like this is classification, classifying. These mails are good mails, they are not spam. These ones are spam. This is regression from the way these values are linked to this line. You're able to predict the next value that will be there, which will be around here. Clustering, you have the same things, but you want to cluster them according to, you don't know them, but when you now cluster, you can be able to say that these are red balls, these are blue balls, these are, but beforehand you didn't know whether these ones are red balls, but because of the features that you have in them, you can cluster them. So that is clustering problems. So those are the three major types of machine learning problems. They're also the three major types of deep learning problems. So you see that some of the features that we see in machine learning, we also see them in deep learning. Now, what are the applications of machine learning? When you talk about machine learning and artificial intelligence, where are they used? Machine learning can be used in web search engine. Like Google uses machine learning to tell you, if you are a football fan, whenever you get to YouTube, you'll be seeing things concerning football. If you're any news that you're interested in, whenever you go to Google to search more of it, you see that when you go to Google app on your phone, you see things concerning that. Photo tagging and photo application, just like I showed you, machine learning can be able to classify photos. Like it sees one, it tells you that, oh, this is a phone, because it has ability to read images. Spam detectors, like I've explained, ability to detect spam cells and spam mails and rest of them. Today, companies are using machine learning to improve business decision, increase productivity, detect disease, forecast weather, and do many more things. Data mining for growth information can be used for this. Application that cannot be programmed, you can use machine learning, just like driverless car, face recognition, handwriting recognition, and so on and so forth. Understanding human learning can also be an application of machine learning. Now we'll talk about the machine learning algorithms. What are the algorithms that you can utilize to solve machine learning problems? Number one is linear regression. we have logistic regression, we have decision tree, we have SVM support vector machine, we have name Bayes, we have KNN, also known as K-nearest neighbors, we have K-means, and we have random forest, etc. There are other ones. Now, what are the terminologies that you use in machine learning? You hear terms like model. You have to prepare your model or build your model. You hear terms like features. Features are those characteristics that you use to identify and classify data into labels. Labels are the target. Training is the ability, is the use of these features and labels to train the model. And you make prediction after you must have trained the model. The essence is to make prediction and tell us what we don't know before. And that is machine learning. Now, there are basic differences between machine learning and traditional programming. In traditional programming, we feed data to a program, run it, and get the output. Whereas in machine learning, we feed data and output together, run it on a machine during training, and the machine creates its own program called logic, which can be evaluated while testing. Now, how does machine learning or deep learning work? Number one thing is that you must gather your data. You get your data of plenty dog or cat images. Now you process this data, you find out the data that are missing, you know how to arrange them. Now you divide the input into training, validation, and test sets. That's what you do next. So after dividing the whole lot of data that you've collected, divide it into training, test, and validation. Now you build your model. After building your model, you test your model and make predictions. Now, what are the prerequisites if you want to learn machine learning? What are the things that you're supposed to know before you start your machine learning? Number one, linear algebra. You're supposed to know that in school when you're learning mathematics. People from engineering background and science background are going to be used to this. Linear algebra, statistic and probability, calculus, graph theory, programming skills. You can use Python. Python is the most used language for machine learning. You can also use R, MATLAB, C++, and Octave. Now we go to deep learning. What is deep learning? Deep learning is an aspect of artificial intelligence that is concerned with emulating the learning approach that human beings use to gain certain types of knowledge. So in deep learning, you're using the concept of neurons in the brain, the way they do their learning. You can see this is neuron. This is a diagram of neuron. And now when you feed input, the neuron takes the weights of these various inputs, adds them, and uses an activation function to fire and predict the output. So the way deep learning works on neurons, that's the way the normal neuron work in the brain, and that's why we call it artificial neural network. Now these are also the diagram that I showed before, showing the relationship between artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. You see that artificial intelligence, the method or major method used in solving artificial intelligence problem is machine learning. And now there is the development of deep learning that is even stronger that we now use in solving artificial intelligence problem. Now, deep learning architectures. What are the deep learning architectures that we have that we are going to study if we want to start solving deep learning problems? We have the artificial neural network, also known as neural network. We have the deep neural network. We have the deep belief network. We have the recurrent neural network. We have the convolutional neural network. We are going to take this one by one. Now, what are the aspects of application of deep learning? Where and where can we see deep learning being used? You can see them in healthcare. If you want to determine whether somebody is going to have cancer, you can take measurements of data concerning the person's body. Then you can use it to predict whether somebody can have cancer so that you can prevent it in future. That is healthcare. Automotive, you'll be hearing about driverless car, automatic driving car, where nobody will be driving, the car will be moving. So they use what we call artificial intelligence, neural network, to find out, to be able to avoid accidents and all those. Automotive, finance and economics, you use neural networks and deep learning to predict the stock prices. Government can use it to monitor a whole lot of cyber crimes and video game. You can use it to automatically play video game against the machine. Military can use it in a whole lot of ways, audit, advertising, and arts. Now, this is basically what a neural network is. A neural network has a set of algorithm, model reasoning after the human brain, and are designed to recognize patterns. So they actually built on neurons. This is neurons. This is the actual diagram of a neuron having node and dendrites from where it receives input. So this will be the node in the neural network. It receives inputs about the features like x1, x2, together with their weights, sums them and fires with an activation function to give an output. This can even be seen more like this. This is a single layer neural network, which because it's having one hidden layer. This is the input layer where you receive various inputs like the shapes of the material being classified. So it receives it here in this neuron, it fires and gives you the output. So this is basically what happens. This is a single, whatever the hidden layer is, just one, call it a single layer perceptron. So this is actually what happens. It receives input with the weights, it sums it and it fires to give output. This is what happens in one single neuron. So these are the neurons. When you have a single hidden layer with the input layer and the output layer, we call it single layer. But when you have plenty hidden layer, like this one, have hidden layer 1, hidden layer 2, hidden layer 3, before the input and output layer, we call it deep neural network. So deep is when the hidden layers are more than one. Now talk about convolutional neural network. When you have to look at the layers, plenty layers, starting like this is human face. But you know that deep inside human base, you have something like all these lines, you understand? These lines make up the nose, the eye, then the nose, the eye make up the face. So you talk about convolutional in image detection, this is exactly the kind of thing that you see in order for you to study. So you have from the line to the next layer where it's coming together to the abstract high level layer where you can see with your eye, like the face. But the face, you know, is built from lines, then the objects of the face like the eyes and the nose before the face. So this is successive model layers learn deeper intermediate representation in convoluted neural network. So this is about where we're going to be stopping today. In subsequent classes, we are going to go dive deep into using those neural network architectures and algorithms to solve real problems. Please, if you like this, hit the subscribe button. If you have any questions and concerns, drop it on the comment section. Thank you and God bless you.